There's a popular adage in Brussels circles that says that if the European Union ever tried to apply for EU membership, it would have to reject itself. Why? Because it's not a democracy. Welcome to Catch the Eye Politics, where we explain how European politics works in practice. Let's talk about democracy. The idea that the EU lacks accountability and representation is not new. The first person to claim that the EU would not fulfill the requirements for EU membership was probably David Martin, a former member of the European Parliament from Scotland, who said it more than 30 years ago. To be fair, back then the European Union was still called the European Community. It only had 12 members, and the four most recent EU treaties had not been written yet. And these have added a lot of democratic elements. But still today, lots of politicians and parties complain that the EU is undemocratic. Political scientists even have a name for it. The democratic deficit. The democratic deficit is the gap between the actions taken by the EU institutions and the ability of ordinary Europeans to directly influence those actions. You might intuitively agree with this, or be surprised. After all, the EU holds elections, has a parliament, and in 2012, it even received the Nobel Peace Prize, in part for the advancement of democracy in Europe. So, how could the EU not be democratic? The first of many hurdles we'll run into with this question is that there's no single definition of democracy, and calling something undemocratic can be a bit of a charged accusation. So to avoid controversy, let's take a scientific approach. One of the most important contributions to democracy research is the Polity Project. Polity classifies all political regimes since 1800 in terms of how democratic or autocratic they are. Researchers use it to understand why some governments fall and others survive. Classification works like this. You rate your country along five dimensions, and depending on your ratings, you find out whether their country is a democracy or a dictatorship. For reference, Finland gets a perfect 10, while Belarus lands on minus 7. As far as I know, no one's ever done this for the European Union, even though it's a polity too. So why don't we give it a try? I should probably mention at this point that I contacted the people behind the Polity Project, and they told me that coding the EU is a nice idea, but should not be done by people without proper training. Anyway, let's just pretend like that never happened and go ahead. Dimension 1. Competitiveness of executive recruitment. In other words, how is the EU's leader chosen? Before we can answer this, we need to decide who leads the EU in the first place. For most countries, it's easy to identify the chief executive. It's the president in the United States and Brazil, the prime minister in the UK and Italy, the chancellor in Germany and Austria, and so on. But the EU is not like most countries. That's our second hurdle. The EU has four main decision-making bodies, as I explained in this video. Two of them have a claim to be the EU's leader, the European Commission and the European Council. So let's just look at both. The European Council has a president, but in practice, he's more like a secretary who moderates meetings and drafts agendas. Calling the shots are the 27 prime ministers, presidents, and chancellors who govern the EU's 27 member states. And each of them is directly or indirectly elected. Meanwhile, the European Commission is headed by a president who holds much of the same powers and responsibilities as your run-of-the-mill prime minister. At the moment, this is Ursula von der Leyen. But how did she get the job? Well, this is hurdle number 3. According to the Lisbon Treaty, candidates for this position are picked by the European Council, taking into account the elections to the European Parliament. If that sounds non-committal to you, that's because it is. Technically, the previous president of the Commission, Jean-Claude Juncker, is the only one who was ever elected by the people, so to speak. He ran as the lead candidate for the European People's Party in the 2014 EU elections, and having won the most votes, was then confirmed by the European Council and the Parliament. This was a new system, designed to make voters pay more attention to the European elections and make the EU a little more democratic in the process. This system is known by a delightfully long German word, Spitzenkandidatenprozess. Ursula von der Leyen, on the other hand, did not win an election. In fact, she wasn't even on the ballot. Here's what happened. Following the 2019 EU elections, the European Council did not like any of the lead candidates. So the leaders locked themselves in a room for 3 days to hash things out. At the end of this meeting marathon stood a roster of appointees for the top jobs in the EU that was more female and climate ambitious than ever before. Geographically and politically balanced, it was a perfect compromise between the conservative, social democratic, and liberal governments in the EU. But nobody had asked the European Parliament. At the time, Ursula von der Leyen was Germany's defense minister and not one of the lead candidates for the commission presidency. So many MEPs thought that she was a pretty undemocratic pick. The parliament's opinion matters because even after you're designated by the European Council, you still need to win the support of an absolute majority of MEPs to become commission president, at least 374. With her idea for a European Green Deal and a bunch of other ambitious policy proposals, von der Leyen managed to do just that, if only by the skin of her teeth and with the help of some questionable allies. So von der Leyen was picked by the political elite, but she was also elected by parliament. But she was not one of the original candidates. But she was a member of the biggest party family. But the election was unopposed. But she almost lost. Dimension 2. Openness of executive recruitment. In other words, who can become the EU's leader? This one's easy. The EU is not a monarchy, so the chief executive is open to any citizen. Though in practice, it's usually a seasoned politician from Western Europe. Dimension 3. Executive constraints, or decision rules. In other words, how constrained is the EU's leader? This one's essentially about how much the EU's leader can do on their own, without the support of other bodies. In this case, it comes in handy that there is no clear chief executive in the EU. Only the European Commission can propose new laws, but the European Council sets the political priorities. Meanwhile, the Council can't pass legislation without the European Parliament. Also, the Commission can be dismissed by the Parliament, and the European Court of Justice keeps all of these bodies in check. In short, no one has all the power. No matter who you consider the leader, they'll be on par with the other accountability groups in the EU. Dimension 4. Regulation of participation. In other words, how is EU politics organized? Let's see. There are 10 parties on the European level, representing a wide spectrum of political views. At the moment, the leaders in the European Council come from 4 of these party families, and a few are unaffiliated. Incidentally, the same is true of the 27 commissioners. The Council changes with national elections and cabinet reshuffles, while the College of Commissioners and the European Parliament change every 5 years following EU-wide elections. There's one next year. There are 7 political groups in the European Parliament, but every MEP is also a member of a national or regional party, meaning that a total of 200 affiliations are currently represented there. If that sounds like it would get chaotic, you'd be surprised at how well things work in Strasbourg and Brussels most of the time. Somehow, MEPs are able to work things out. Granted, the political groups love changing their names and logos every few years, and sometimes MEPs jump ship and change alliances. In fact, just a few years ago, after a lot of back and forth, the biggest political group, the Conservative EPP, lost its 12 members from the Hungarian Fidesz party. And of course, Brexit also brought about a big shift, shrinking the size of the parliament from 751 to 705 seats in 2020. But all in all, the EU's political system is diverse yet stable, with most groups' histories going back several decades. Sounds pretty regulated to me. Dimension 5. Competitiveness of participation. In other words, how open is the EU's political system to opposition? We already talked about the crazy amount of parties and groups that are active on the European level, which is a good indicator of how much political competition there is. Another sign that the EU's political system is pretty open to opposition comes from the many European parties and politicians that want to limit the powers and responsibilities of the EU level, the so-called Eurosceptics. Some of them have even called for their country to quit the EU altogether, although this has become much less common ever since Brexit showed us what can happen with that. And then there's the fact that the top jobs in Brussels are always held by people from different party families. Sometimes they even change hands in the middle of the term, as with the president of the European Parliament. So it's safe to say that EU politics is pretty competitive. Now let's add up the polity points. So there we go. Polity was developed with conventional nation-states in mind, so we ran into a couple of hiccups. But all in all, it looks like the EU is a veritable democracy. No democratic deficit here. Case closed. But this wasn't very satisfying, was it? That's probably because democracy is about more than just parties and politicians. It's about protests and petitions, lobbying and volunteering, rallies and boycotts, it's sending letters to representatives, and devoting your career towards a political goal. In short, it's about getting your voice heard by the people who make decisions. None of that is really captured by the polity score, as scientific as it is. So let's look at it another way. In fact, let's look at it like the European Union does. There's a section in the Lisbon Treaty titled the Provisions on Democratic Principles. This should be a good place to look for the EU's own view of democracy. Article 8a, paragraph 3 is especially relevant here. It says, every citizen shall have the right to participate in the democratic life of the Union. Decisions shall be taken as openly and as closely as possible to the citizen. Doesn't this kind of sound like a response to the democratic deficit? So, how do the EU's aspirations hold up against reality? Well, to start with the first sentence, citizens certainly have the right to participate in the democratic life of the Union. As an EU citizen, you are free to vote and run in the elections to the European Parliament, and anyone can get involved in political campaigns, donate money to candidates, contact representatives, or boycott the political system if they so prefer. If you have a complaint about an EU institution, you can ask the European Ombudsman to investigate them. At the moment, this is Emily O'Reilly. Or you can just go out into the street and stage a good old-fashioned protest, whether it's against the EU or in support of it. Oh, and let's not forget about Brexit. It's pretty darn democratic to let EU citizens vote to leave the EU altogether, isn't it? And then there's the European Citizens Initiative. With just 1 million signatures from at least 7 different member states, your idea too can get ignored by the European Commission. Out of just 9 successful European Citizens Initiatives since 2012, only one is set to result in an actual new EU law later this year. To be sure, most EU citizens don't make much use of all of these rights anyway. Have you ever signed an ECI? Have you ever contacted a member of the European Parliament? Maybe you've never even voted in the EU elections. Yes, there are all these things that EU citizens have the right to do. But in practice, they just don't. Is that the EU's fault? Maybe a little. I mean, the EU is pretty hard to understand, and it just doesn't seem all that important, does it? The fact that many people instinctively agree with this is a democratic shortcoming of the EU. The Champions League is pretty hard to understand, but a lot of people care about it. It's less about how complicated the EU is, and more about how much people feel it matters to their personal lives. This brings us to the second sentence. Decisions shall be taken as openly and as closely as possible to the citizen. Let's talk about openly. On this, it strongly depends what part of the EU you're looking at. The European Parliament is extremely transparent. It broadcasts almost all of its meetings online, publishes virtually all documents, and is pretty responsive to the public in general. The European Commission is also very good about publishing and archiving documents. Like most governments around the world, its meetings are not open to the public, but officials spend a lot of time explaining their decisions to the press. That said, some people have called the Commission's internal practices less than democratic. Plus, it would probably be best to also give the Parliament the right to draft new legislation. But let's not forget that many countries around the world also heavily rely on government ministries to make laws and aren't very transparent about that process either. And then there's the Council. Most of its meetings are held behind closed doors, and almost none of its documents are published in a timely manner. I am morally obligated to point out that the Council is run by the member states, not by Brussels. Fix it, capitals. A lot of people also criticize trilogues, the legislative negotiations between the Parliament, the Council, and the Commission. But there's something to be said for tricky negotiations staying confidential to give everyone space for some give and take. And at least we always get to see the final outcome. Perhaps a bigger problem is that despite all of this transparency, almost nobody knows where to find all these live streams and recordings and documents. It doesn't help that navigating EU websites can make you feel like Indiana Jones looking for the Holy Grail. Finally, let's talk about closely. Some people think that close to the citizen means that most decisions should be taken at the local level. I don't think it's that simple. Just because a decision was taken by your local town council doesn't mean you're going to agree with it, or even ever find out about it for that matter. Even so, the EU does have internal guidelines for taking decisions at the lowest possible level, and for giving citizens a voice in the lawmaking process. We discussed some of these mechanisms in this video. But instead of thinking about this in such procedural terms, why don't we just ask the citizens themselves? They'll be the best judge. Well, according to a recent survey, only 43% of Europeans agree that their voice counts in the EU, while 53% disagree. For reference, a much higher 58% of respondents agree that their voice counts in their country, while just 40% disagree. And there's more. If you watched this video, you may remember that regional policy makes up about a third of the EU's budget, 62 billion euros just last year. But it seems that most Europeans are pretty oblivious to this massive cash flow. just 16% of respondents think that they have personally benefited from an EU-funded cohesion program in their daily lives, while 80% say they have not. When the opposite is probably true. So if you ask the citizens, the EU is pretty far away from them. And it makes sense. I mean, the EU basically started out as an international organization and only slowly grew into a more government-like system. Originally, the EU didn't need to be democratic. It just needed to work well. So, is the EU a dictatorship? No. I mean, do this whole exercise for any other democratic country, and you'll have just as much to criticize, if not more. But the EU does have some room to grow before we can call it a thriving beacon of democracy. The problem is not that there aren't enough political parties or checks and balances. If anything, there may be too many. The problem is that most people don't know what's going on, and the EU is not doing a great job of explaining it. But that's why we're here, isn't it? We only looked at the internal functioning of the EU in this video, and that's what the democratic deficit usually refers to. But I think it's worth noting the EU's huge positive impact on democracy in Europe and around the world. That's what that Nobel Peace Prize was for. Everybody likes to criticize the EU's handling of democratic backsliding in member states like Hungary and Poland. But who knows where they would be if it weren't for the EU? I dare guess, much closer to Belarus than to Finland. That's it for this video. Find our sources in the description, hit like if you liked it, subscribe if you want more, and leave a comment below if you've got some thoughts to share. And as always, keep your eyes open.